The spun hematocrit measures the volume of packed red cells in a given volume of whole blood. This method uses EDTA anticoagulated whole blood or capillary blood obtained by finger stick. In this video, we will be performing this test on a control sample and a patient sample. The test is performed in duplicate, so two microhematocrit tubes will be filled 2/3 full for each sample. We will begin by preparing the patient sample. While preparing the patient sample, make sure your control is set out so it can warm to room temperature. Mix the EDTA blood specimen by tilting the tube approximately 6 times before taking the blood sample. This will allow for adequate cell suspension. Remove the cap with the tube facing away from you. Carefully tilt the EDTA sample so that the blood moves closer to the open end of the tube. Place one end of the microhematocrit tube in the blood and then tilt the microhematocrit tube down. It will fill with capillary action. Place your finger on the opposite end of the capillary tube and hold it there to stop the blood at the correct height. Tube should be about 2/3 full. If you happen to get bubbles in the tube, that's okay. Seal your 2/3 full microhematocrit tube with clay. Notice that there is a dry end and a wet end of the tube. The wet end of the tube is the end that was submerged in blood to fill the tube with blood. Hold the microhematocrit tube horizontally and wipe off the wet end of the tube with a Kleenex. Place your finger over the wet end of the tube. With your finger capping the wet end, rotate the tube vertically with the dry end down and push this end into the clay. Repeat this step a few times so there's a good amount of clay in the tube to plug the dry end. The clay plug will prevent the blood from running out of the tube during centrifugation. Set the filled microhematocrit tube on the white mat. Repeat this process for the second tube. If your sample runs completely through the tube so that you no longer have a dry end, discard the microhematocrit tube and start over with a new tube. The clay should contact dry glass in order to hold blood during centrifugation. You need to be able to see a dry space in the tube between the clay and your blood sample. Once blood tubes have clay plugs, place tubes in the hematocrit sheet holders. Now we're going to repeat this process with the control vial once again, filling two tubes because we performed this test in duplicate. So once again, mix the whole blood control vial by tilting, not shaking, approximately 6 times. When the sample has been well mixed, remove the cap with the vial facing away from you. Carefully tilt the vial so the sample flows to the open end of the tube. Place one end of the microhematocrit tube in the blood and then gradually tilt the microhematocrit tube downward until the tube is 2/3 full of blood. Once your tube is 2/3 full, wipe off the wet end of the tube with a Kleenex and clay the dry end of the tube by placing your finger over the wet end of the tube. Holding the tube vertically, place the dry end of the tube in the clay block. Remember to repeat this step multiple times so there's a good amount of clay in the tube. Repeat this process again for the second tube. Place your control tubes in a different hematocrit sheet holder. Label the sheet with your name and patient name. Carefully transport the tubes to the centrifuge area, making sure to hold onto the sheet and the tubes with your fingers so the tubes do not slip out. Open the centrifuge and remove the lid. Notice that the centrifuge has grooves. These are the grooves that you will place your microhematocrit tubes in. Place the patient and control microhematocrit tubes in the centrifuge with the clay plug facing out by first tucking the clay end under the rubber lip of the outer edge. Make sure the clay end is against the rubber wall in the groove. Make sure you balance each microhematocrit tube. Record the centrifuge number and groove numbers used for each microhematocrit tube on the sheet. Secure the centrifuge lid by pressing down until it clicks in place and close the centrifuge. Centrifuge tubes for 5 minutes at approximately 12,000 RPM. Do not adjust the centrifuge speed or time as this has been validated for each individual hematocrit centrifuge. After centrifugation is finished, remove the microhematocrit tubes from the centrifuge and place them back in the microhematocrit tube holders in the correct holes. Transfer the sheet back to your workstation, making sure to hold the tubes and sheet. We are going to start by reading the values of the control microhematocrit tubes. To do this, we use a hematocrit manual card reader. On the card, there are two charts to place the tube to determine the hematocrit value. In general, we will use the chart on the right. However, if there is a low volume, the chart on the left would be used. Notice on the reader, there is a zero mark at the bottom and a 100 mark at the top. To begin reading the tubes, lay the reader flat on the table and align the area of the hematocrit tube where the packed red cells and the clay meet at the zero mark. Move or roll the tube along the card until the meniscus of the plasma aligns with the 100 mark, which is the top line. Once you find this point, look at the line at the top of the packed red cells, excluding the buffy coat. Follow this line to the corresponding value. This is the hematocrit percentage. We read this value to the nearest 0.5%. We are going to read both control hematocrit tubes, and in order to accept the results, the values must agree within plus or minus 1%. The 1% equals 1 hematocrit percentage point. Our first control tube is 34.0%, and our second control tube value is also 34.0%. Since they agree within 1% of each other, we can accept those results. We will take the average of the two values and we will report our result to the nearest 0.5%. So our final control hematocrit value is 34.0%. Since we report to the nearest 0.5%, if we were to obtain hematocrit results such as 32.5% and 33.0%, we would not take the average because we would get an average of 32.75%, which would not be reporting to the nearest 0.5%. In this instance, we would report either 32.5% value or the 33.0% value. Now we have to determine if our QC was acceptable overall. To do this, we're going to chart our value on the Levin-Jennings chart, which was 34%. And if our value is within plus or minus 2 standard deviations of the assayed control mean, then it is acceptable and we can report our patient sample hematocrit value. If the control is not within the acceptable limits, first check that you are using the hematocrit reader properly. If the hematocrit control is still not within acceptable range, testing must be repeated. Once the hematocrit controls are acceptable, read the patient's hematocrit tubes. Our first microhematocrit value is 35.0%, and our second microhematocrit value is 35.0%. We are within 1%, so we can take the average, which is 35.0%, and report that. If less than 1% difference, that is 0.5%, do not average the patient hematocrit results, report either.